الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى The four imams, we did Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Malik, and Al-Imam Shafi'i. Since we only have one imam left, we're going to do it today, inshallah ta'ala. And the last of the four imams is who? Al-Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. And the way that I plan, bi-idhnillah al-kareem, to go through Al-Imam Ahmed is in these five steps, inshallah ta'ala. These five steps are the way that I'm going to go through Imam Ahmed's biography and also his madhab. Okay? First of all, as we always do, we speak in a summarized, abridged manner. We speak about the Imam himself. So here we're going to be speaking about who? Al-Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. And the way that I'm going to be speaking about Al-Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal is in two ways. When I talk about the biography of Al-Imam Ahmed, I'm going to be speaking about him in two ways. The first one is Hayatu al-Shakhsiyya, his personal life. I will be mentioning that inshallah ta'ala. And the second one is Hayatu al-Ilmiyya, which is his academic achievements, his educational background. And that's the one I'm going to focus more on, inshallah ta'ala. The second inshallah ta'ala is Talamidhu, the students of Al-Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. And Imam Ahmed has hundreds of students. But I can't go through all of them. So I've chosen to mention these five. The first one being Abu Bakr al-Marudi. The second one is Al-Muhanna ibn Yahya al-Shami. And the third is Abu Bakr al-Asram. And the fourth one is Harb ibn Ismail al-Karmani. And the fifth one is Ibrahim ibn Ishaq al-Harbi rahimahullah. Those are the five prominent students of Al-Imam Ahmed, whose names you will come across in books of hadith. You'll come across. The third, inshallah ta'ala, is some of the stages of the madhab of Al-Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. And what does Al-Imam Ahmed's madhab stand on? What are its foundations which it stands on? And there are three, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is Aqwaluhu fil kutub, the statements of Al-Imam Ahmed that you find in well-known books. And these books are generally called Masailu Ahmed, questions that were put to Imam Ahmed. So you go to those kind of books, Masailu Ahmed, questions that were put to Imam Ahmed. That's the first source in the madhab of the Hanabila. Are we all together, brothers? The questions that were asked to Imam Ahmed and the answers that he gave, alayhi rahmatullahi. The second one is Taqriju ala aqwalihi. Ahmed's speeches, they're going to be taken and they're going to be applied in different situations now. Are we all together, brothers? Incidents that he himself, Ahmed, did not give a verdict for, but they will take that fatwa of his and they will apply it in other places. And we spoke about the issue of takhrij, what it means, right? We mentioned it when we were speaking about Madhab al-Hanbali. The third one is ijtihadat, ulama al-Madhab. The Hanabila, they have scholars who do ijtihad within the madhab. Who do what? They do ijtihad. And we'll mention some of those imams who were well known to do ijtihad. And they are the mujtahideen of the madhab. And they are called the muhaqqiqeen. We'll touch on who they are and their names, inshallah ta'ala. Number four, ahammu al-mu'allafati fil madhab al-hanbali. The most prominent, the most well-known books in the Hanbali madhab. There are many books, but we're going to mention the most important ones. But if you want to study madhab Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, then this inshallah ta'ala is what? the books that you should try to buy in order to study the madhab. Last but not least, اصطلاحات الحنابلة. Hanabila have اصطلاحات, they have terms which they use amongst themselves. Okay, what are these terms? What do they mean to them? And this we did for all of the madhabs, right? So the istilahat is terminologies that are used by the scholars of the madhab. And you will never be able to read a madhab book if you don't understand their istilahat, their terminologies. First of all, Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he is آخر المذاهب الأربعة. He is the four famous, well-known Imams of the madhab, right? He's the last of the four, right? The first one is Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, and the second one is Al-Imam Malik, and the third one is Al-Imam Shafi'i, and the fourth one is Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal is the last of the four. He's the last of the four. Al-Imam Ahmad, his name is Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal. His name is Ahmed. His father's name is Muhammad. Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal. So he's called Ahmed. His father is called what? Muhammad. And his granddad is called what? Hanbal. And his great granddad is called Shayban. So his name is Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Shayban. So he's Shaybaniyun, he's known as. His kunya is Abu Abdullah because he had a son called Abdullah. But Abdullah wasn't the oldest of his sons. He wasn't the oldest. I think Salih was older than him. Like Abdullah is from his sons. And the most knowledgeable from his children. Abdullah. And Al-Imam Ahmed, he never got married until he reached 40. Ta'akhara fi zawaj. He felt there was a need to do that. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. Because he wanted to free his mind and his heart for knowledge. And it was mentioned that when his wife passed away, Ahmed married the next day. She died, the next day he got married. It's mentioned in his biography. So, that is Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala. He was born when the year was 164 Hijriya. He was born in the month of Rabi' al-Awwal, when the year was 164 Hijriya. And some said, no, it wasn't Rabi' al-Awwal, it's actually Rabi' al-Akhir. It is Rabi' al-Akhir is the one he was born. I'm a Rabi' al-Akhir. Imam Ahmad كان إماما في الحديث. Imam Ahmad is an Imam in Hadith, number one. Write that down. He's an Imam في الحديث. He is also Imam في السنة, and we already mentioned the difference between the two. He's an Imam في الحديث, meaning صناعة الحديثية, the concept of Hadith, authenticating, weakening narrations, the science of Hadith. He was an Imam in that science. And he was also Imam في السنة. Imam fi sunnah means he was an imam in the aqeed of Ahl sunnah wal jama'ah. وَلِذَلِكَ he is called Imam Ahl sunnah wal jama'ah. Ahmed was called. What was he called? Imam Ahl sunnah wal jama'ah. And he was also Imam fil fiqh. Are you with me, brothers? As for Imam Ahmed being Imam fil hadith, it's a mahallu ijma'ah. It's a consensus that he's an Imam in hadith. As for him being an imam fi sunnah, it's also mahallu ijma' according to Ahlul Sunnah that he's an imam in sunnah. There's no khilaf amongst Ahlul Sunnah regarding Imam Ahmed's imamah in sunnah. Lakin there are people who questioned Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, his imamah in fiqh. And they are man la yultafatu ilayhim. There are people we don't give a look to them. In that statement regarding Ahmed. And we will respond to that inshallah ta'ala. That he was an imam fil fiqh. Ahmed was an imam fil fiqh. The reason why his teachers, not his students only, but his teachers, they affirm that for him. Are we all together, brothers? His teachers, who were agreed by the scholars to be fuqaha, they said Ahmed is a faqih. So what does that make Ahmed? A faqih. A imamun fil fiqh. So we say that he is an imamun fil fiqh. And he has qasab al-sabq. He is at the forefront when it comes to fiqh. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. As for those who said al-imam Ahmed, he's a muhaddith, he's only a scholar of hadith, and walaysa bifaqih, it is not what we give weight to. And you know why they said that? The reason why they said that Imam Ahmed is a muhaddith and he's not a faqih is because whenever he was asked a question, he would always say haddathana, meaning he will mention a chain of narration for it. Everything Ahmed said, what would he say? He would mention a chain of narration for it. I mean, he wouldn't say something except if he had a hadith for it. And so they said he's a muhaddith, laysa bifaqih. And that is not correct. Great scholars affirmed for him, admitted that he's an imam. Let's take some of those imams. Imams who were imams in fiqh. Number one, Ibrahim al-Harbi, who died in the year 285. Ibrahim al-Harbi. Ibrahim al-Harbi is an imam in fiqh. He said, "Adraktu thalathatan." I met three people. What did I meet? I met three people. Ta'jizu an-nisa. Women are unable. An yalidna mithlahum. Mothers are unable to give birth to the likes of them. Three people I met, mothers are unable to give birth to the likes of them. First one is, Ra'aytu Aba Ubaid. I saw Aba Ubaid. Fama mathaltu illa bijabalin nufikhat fihi ar-ruh. I met Abu Ubaid, Qasim al-Salam, and I could not give a parable, an example of him, except a mountain that it was blown into him a life. Meaning, he's a mountain. He doesn't move in his knowledge and his understanding. وَرَأَيْتُ بِشْرِ بْنُ الْحَارِثِ. Second person is, I met Bishr ibn al-Harith. فَمَا شَبَّهْتُهُ. And there was no parable, example I could give to this great imam, except a person who from the tip of his head to the tip of his toes, Allah filled it with aql, smart individual. وَرَأَيْتُ أَحْمَدْ بْنَ حَنْبَلْ. And I saw Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. فَرَأَيْتُ. And what I saw was, كَأَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ جَمَعَ لَهُ عِلْمَ الْأَوَّلِينَ. Allah combined in this man the knowledge of the early people. That's what I saw. فَمِنْ كُلِّ صِنْفٍ يَقُولُ مَا شَاءَ. Everything he would say what he wanted. وَيُمْسِكُ مَا شَاءَ. And he would leave off what he wanted. Meaning he had the ability to speak about anything, Imam Ahmed. And he would speak as much as he wanted. And he could hold back from it as much as he wanted. It wasn't that when he held back, it was lack of ability to say more. He could say more if he wanted to, but he just felt to be quiet about it. That's his knowledge. Imam Ahmed was said that he memorized 1 million hadith. Hifd, that's how it was. 1 million hadith with his chain. Ahmed memorized it. Rahimahullah. And Ibn al-Qayyim said, وَلَوْ أَرَدْتُ. If I wanted to, I believe Ahmed had memorized more than that. Ibn al-Qayyim said this. Abu Ubaid, who I just mentioned, who died in 224 Hijriyah, he said, رَبَّانِيُّ الْحَدِيثِ أَرْبَعَ. The Rabbani are the godly scholars. Allah, what did he say in the Quran? وَكُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ وَكُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تُعَلِّمُونَ الْكِتَابُ وَبِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَدْرُسُونَ. كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ, be scholars who nurture the people and cultivate them in the way that please Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah told us to be like that. Abu Ubaid, he said that the Rabbaniyu of Hadith, those who cultivate the people accordingly, are four. And from those four, فَأَعْلَمُوا بِالْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ أَحْمَدِ. From the four, the one who knew the most in the halal and the haram, which is what? Fiqh, right? That's fiqh. The most knowledgeable one of them was who? Ahmad ibn Hanbal. That's a testimony from who? That's a shahada from who? Imam Abu Ubaid Qasim Salam. Abdul Razak ibn Hamam al-Sal'ani, who said, who's the teacher of Imam Ahmad? He said, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَفْقَهُ. I never saw anyone who had more fiqh. Who had more fiqh. وَلَا أَرْوَعَ. And I never saw anyone who stayed away from doubtful issues min Ahmad ibn Hanbal than Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Imam al-Shafi'i, look what he said about him. Imam who? Imam al-Shafi'i. He said, خَرَجْتُ مِنْ Baghdad. And I want you guys to understand, Shafi'i's time, Ahmad was young. And this was Ahmad before he even went to Egypt and built the new madhab. Are we all together, brothers? What did he say? خَرَجْتُ مِنْ Baghdad. Shafi'i said, I left Baghdad. Because who was his student in Baghdad? We mentioned it yesterday. In Baghdad, Al-Karabisi, Abu Thawr, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Ishaq ibn Rahuya, all of these were the students of Imam Shafi'i, where? In Iraq, Baghdad. He said, خَرَجْتُ مِنْ Baghdad. So all of these students, Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad Za'farani as well, all of them I left them in Egypt. In Baghdad. لَكِنْ فَمَا خَلَّفْتُ فِيهَا رَجُلًا. I never left a man behind. أَفْضَلَ, more virtuous. وَلَا أَعْلَمَ, more knowledgeable. وَلَا أَفْقَهَ, and has more fiqh. وَلَا أَتْقَى, and has more taqwa. من أحمد بن حنبل. تلا الإمام أحمد بن حنبل. How many things did he say? He said, أفضل, more virtuous. أعلم, more knowledgeable. أفقه, has more fiqh. ولا أتقى, and has more تقوى. Then who? أحمد بن حنبل. إسحاق بن راهوية, who died in 238, he said, أحمد, الإمام أحمد, حجة, he's a proof, بين الله وبين خلقه, between Allah and His creation. أحمد is a proof from Allah against the people. He is. And we'll see why they say these statements. We'll see why they said these statements. Abu Thawr. Abu Thawr is who? Abu Thawr was a student of Imam al-Shafi'i, and some of the scholars, they said he had his own madhab, and his madhab perished. Him and Sufyan al-Thawri and al-Awza'i and Abu Thawr and others, they had their madhab, but it didn't spread. Abu Thawr, look what he said. He said, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Ahmad, أعلم أو أفقه من الثوري. Ahmad has more fiqh than Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan al-Thawri, nobody argued about his fiqh. He said, no, Ahmad is more knowledgeable. Has more fiqh than Sufyan al-Thawri, رحمه الله. Abu Zur'a al-Razi said, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Ahmad, أكبر من إسحاق. Ahmad ibn Hanbal is greater than إسحاق ibn راهوية. Meaning he's bigger than him in knowledge and fiqh. He's more knowledgeable than him. ما رأيت, I never saw أحدا, a person أكمل من أحمد. I've never seen anyone more complete than Imam Ahmad in all areas of the religion. Never saw anyone like that. So the scholars, they testified for his knowledge. رحمه الله رحمة واسعة. ولذلك الإمام الذهبي يسأل نسير أعلام النبلاء, كان أحمد عظيم الشأن. كان أحمد عظيم الشأن. الإمام أحمد affairs was great. رأسا في الحديث. He was a leader in hadith. وَفِي الْفِقْهِ. And he was a leader in fiqh. وَفِي التَّأَلُّهِ. And in ibadah. Ahmed's ibadah was good, was great. أَسْنَى عَلَيْهِ خَلْقٌ. Many people praised Al-Imam Ahmed. مِنْ خُصُومِهِ. His opponents, those who were against Al-Imam Ahmed, even they praised him. فَمَا الظَّنُّ بِإِخْوَانِهُ وَأَقْرَانِهُ. Zahabi then said, what do you think about those who are his friends? Those who are his peers, what would they say about him? If his enemies have testified to Ahmed ibn Hanbal rahimahullah, his knowledge and everything. And Imam Ahmed, his position in the Sunnah and the way that he was when it came to innovation and the people of innovation was very staunch and he was very tough. وَلِذَلِكَ, he used to say, قُولُوا لِأَهْلِ الْبِدَعِ. Say to the people of innovation, بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمُ الْجَلَائِسِ. أَمَا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ يَوْمُ الْجَلَائِسِ. Innovators, between you and us is the day of the burial, the funeral. Because when the scholar of the Sunnah dies, the earth, the people, even the creatures and everything miss him. Because the scholar is the reason why Allah protects catastrophes and heart and destructions to nations. Because the reason why Allah sends down uquba, punishments, is because of sins that the people do. And the scholar is there to tell the people to stay away from those sins and bring it to the people's attentions. Are we all together? So the scholar is what? He's the one who saves the people from destruction coming. And when they listen to their advice, the scholar's advice, and they take the nasa'ih and the tawjihat of the scholars, the land, the people, the animals, they get saved. وَلِذَلِكَ ponder. Why did the Prophet say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَحَتَّ الْحِيْتَانُ فِي جَوْفِ الْمَاءِ. Even the creatures in the ocean ask Allah's forgiveness for the scholar. Why? Because they can be in the ocean and they can remain in the ocean and they can live that life of blossom and bliss because of Allah not sending devastation and destruction. And one of the ways Allah does is by a scholar being in a land. When the scholars are in a land and they are there to help the people and advise the people, then that land and those people are saved. So Ahmed used to say, the day of the burial will be known who was beneficial for the people and who will be of khair for the people. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, أَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَسَالَتْ أَوْدِيَةٌ بِقَدَرِهَا فَاحْتَمَلَ السَّيْلُ زَبَدًا رَابِيًا. The rain comes down, the earth, when it comes to taking the rain, is different types, right? Some parts of the land, they don't take the water. Some parts of the land, they take the water. Some land doesn't take in the water, but it holds the water, so somebody else can use the water, but it doesn't benefit from the water. And then Allah said after that, وَأَمَّا مَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسَ فَيَمْكُثُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The thing that's going to benefit the people, and that's going to bring the people benefit, will remain on this earth even when the person dies. When the scholar dies and he goes, and he passes away, because he was beneficial for the ummah, when he dies, his khair and his good will remain forever. And whatever benefits the people will remain. And whatever, brothers, that doesn't benefit the people will go. So Ahmed ibn Hanbal, like every other scholar, he went through his trials and tribulations. Because from the sunnah of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and the way Allah is subhanahu wa ta'ala is, in order to raise you, in order to make you become something, Allah has to put you through a test. You have to go through a competition. And وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah is a great example. Like even in this world, in order to take a prize, you have to go through a competition. And in order to take the prize of imamah, to become an imam, you will have to go through the test of time. And Ahmed was tested. And at his time, he was tested because of the concept of the Qur'an being created. The Qur'an is makhluq. The Qur'an is created. And Ahmed took a very strong position. And he refused to give in. And he said that the Qur'an, wallahi, is not created. It's the speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And at that time, the scholars were being tested. You see, they were not allowed to be silent. The leader was saying, is the Quran created, yes or no? That's the test. There's no getting away from it. Ahmed rahimahullah looked around, and what he saw was the people were writing. They were looking at his mouth. And he has pressure put on it from the government. And the people are looking at him, they want to write what he says. If he doesn't say the Quran is created, he will go to prison and he will go through a very hard and tough consequences. And if he says that the Quran is created, these people are going to write that and they're going to document it and they're going to say this is the belief of the belief of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So Ahmed thought deeply and he chose to say that the Quran is not created. And as soon as he said that, others were killed in prison. Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala, he got taken into prison. And the leader at that time, he commanded Ahmed to be given a set of lashes daily. And Ahmed did not crack, nor did he change his position, nor did he stop saying that the Quran is the speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Until the leader thought, why is this man not cracking? So he came down himself to the place and he beat Ahmed to his own. And Ahmed rahimahullah would not change from his position that the Quran is not created. ولذلك, some of the stories that were mentioned was, Ahmed said, one day I was sitting thinking about my situation. فرأيت أعرابي, I saw a Bedouin man walking from far. And he came to me and he said to him, Anta Aba Abdullah, are you Aba Abdullah? Ahmed ibn Hanbal. And he said, yes, I am. I am Ahmed ibn Hanbal. He said, do you love Allah and His Messenger? Ahmed said, I love Allah and His Messenger. And then he said to him, if you love Allah and His Messenger, then all that you're going to go through is darbatan hahuna. You might get killed for holding your position on this belief. But you will meet the one you love, Allah and His Messenger. Ahmed then said, rahimahullah, فَكُنْتُ, I used to be one who remembers the speech of that Bedouin man whenever I used to get lashed. It would always come to my mind. It was a form of encouragement for me. Another man in prison with Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he saw Ahmed, both of them together. And he said to Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah, handle and take in the pain of the beating. Take it, accept it. Endure the pain for the position that you've put yourself because you're holding onto the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. He said, as for me, I have a number of lashes for committing sins, zina and whatnot. The government has set a number of lashes for me. And you know what? I get lashed and I go back and I do it again, I get lashed. I'm enduring it for the joy I get. How can you not endure it, Ahmed? Huh? For the statement of the Quran not being created? Are you with me, brothers? So Ahmed, rahimahullah, these statements, they encouraged him. And the benefit that we take from this, brothers, is if a person's practicing the deen and they are trying their hardest, statements of encouragement can sometimes go far. It can help a person at the time when they are lowest and they may even leave the religion. A statement that you said, a word of encouragement that you said, you know what? Remarkable. It's a remarkable thing you're doing. Keep your head high up. Can help them at a time they would have broken or given up. And it helped Al-Imam Ahmed, ma'a imamati, with his knowledge and his understanding. He didn't say, I remembered ayat and hadith. What is it that he said he remembered? I remember the statement of a Bedouin man. His statement helped me. So it helps a person. Encouragement is one of the best ways to push somebody. So Al-Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, he died. He died rahimahullah. And when he died, his janazah, a lot of people came. خَلْقٌ كَثِيرٌ. The number of people that came to his janazah was so much, to the extent that the people, they opened their doors for the people to walk through them. And they also opened their doors and their houses for people to do wudu. The five daily prayers, people were still coming to the janazah of Imam Muhammad rahimahullah ta'ala. And the people, the passage and the roads were fully crowded, that people had to open their front door and their back door so people could go through. That the people could go through. All of what? Shiddatul Ziham. It was very crowded. Because he's a man who spread the religion of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are you with me, brothers? And that's what Allah does, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ahmed rahimahullahu ta'ala. And he became and got called Imam Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. He got called Imam Ahl Sunnah. They gave him that title. If you really want to look into Imam Ahmed's life in great details, the best book for it is طبقات الحنابلة by Abu Ya'la al-Farra. طبقات الحنابلة is the best book to read Al-Imam Ahmed's biography. And if you buy that book, طبقات الحنابلة by Abu Ya'la, and the best tahqiq is the tahqiq of AbdulRahman al-Uthaymeen. AbdulRahman al-Uthaymeen, this is not the son of Muhammad Salih al-Uthaymeen. He's from the same tribe as him, but this man is a doctor from the University of Umm al-Qura. He's a great muhaqqiq, great scholar of tahqiq, a master in tahqiqat al-kutub. The best tahqiq is his one. If you buy that book, the first is called طبقات الحنابلة, meaning it talks about all of the scholars of the Hanbali madhab. Who does he start with? Imam Ahmed. He starts with him. Read it. He brings quotes that Imam Ahmed said. A lot of things that you're going to find there, inshallah ta'ala. Now we're going to go into the students of Imam Ahmed. Imam Ahmed's students, there are many, but these are the most well-known ones. Abu Bakr al-Marudi, Muhanna ibn Yahya al-Shamiyu, Abu Bakr al-Athram, Harb ibn Ismail al-Kirmani. Harb ibn Ismail al-Kirmani, brothers, he has a kitab in Aqidah, right? He has a what? He has a kitab in? It's called Mu'taqad Ahli Sunnati wal-Jama'ah. He has a good book in Aqidah. And the other one is Ibrahim ibn Ishaq al-Harbiyu. These are from the students of Al-Imamu. And of course, from his students is Abu Dawood al-Sijistani. You all know that. Al-Imam Abu Dawood, rahimahullah. He's from him. Al-Imam al-Bukhari is a student of who? Al-Imam al-Bukhari is a student of who? Al-Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah ta'ala. So Al-Imam Ahmed has many students. He has what? Has many, many students. And people used to come to him from all over the world to meet him, to talk to him, to sit with him. From one of his students is Baqiyat ibn Makhlad. From the students of Imam Ahmed is who? Baqiyat ibn Makhlad. And we mentioned the story of Baqiyat ibn Makhlad in the Tariq al-Tadwin al-Sunnah, right? When we're talking about the history of the Sunnah, how it was formed and how it developed. Baqiyat ibn Makhlad, he came from what? Andalus. And he said that I didn't take a riding beast. I walked to Iraq. Okay? I walked with my legs. Who did he go to? Who did he want to meet? Ahmed. Ahmed at that moment, what situation was Ahmed in when Baqiyat ibn Makhlad? Baqiyat left Andalus? Baqiyat left Andalus? He walked to Iraq. He went to Iraq. And then the first day he went to Iraq, he sat in a masjid, just like this, in the morning, Fajr. Who was sitting there? One of the great imams of that time. He was given a lesson. This imam was Imam Yahya ibn Ma'in. Yahya ibn Ma'in was given the dars. And Yahya ibn Ma'in is imam fil jarh wa ta'adil. He's an imam in what? the criticism and the praise of the scholars. Like he criticizes narrators and he praises narrators. He's a scholar who knows the narrations and how, if this narration is weak or not. So Baqiyat ibn Makhlad, when he came into the masjid, he sat down like everybody else and he listened to the lesson and then he put his hand up. Because everybody was asking a person, right? So he said, what do you think of Ahmad ibn Hanbal? And then Yahya got taken back. He said, Mithli yus'alu an Ahmad. Is someone like me asked about Ahmad? No. He said, ask Ahmad about me. Ask who? Ask Ahmad ibn Hanbal about Yahya ibn Ma'in. Ahmad at that moment was in house prison. He wasn't allowed to come out. He wasn't allowed to teach. He wasn't allowed to do anything. Are you with your brothers? What amazed me a lot was Ahmad, even though he was put in prison, the leader came down from his palace. He beat Ahmad. You know what Al-Imam Ahmad said? Al-Imam Ahmad looked at his chains that he had on him. Abu Ya'la mentions this in his Tabaqatul Hanabila. He looked at his chains and he said, if the leader only took these chains off me, I would never run out of prison in obedience to him. I would never take my chains off. Wallahi, he said that. Rahimahullah. And even when he came out of prison, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he used to make dua for the leader. He used to. Even that the statement was what? A statement of disbelief. To say that the Quran is created is a statement of disbelief. Ba'adhalik Ahmad, rahimahullah, he used to say, these deviates, mu'tazila, are the ones who confuse the leader. They're the ones who pushed this belief under him and made him think that this was what Allah and His Messenger wanted. He said, if he took these chains off me, I would not run away from prison. I would obey him. I'm not allowed to. So what did he understand, Ahmad rahimahullah? Ahmad understood that the religion is not compromised. Like in the overall and general obedience of the leader has to be in place, or else the land is going to be corruption and fawba. Does that make sense? Like, لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. Just the same with your mother. You obey your mother in all of the things that she tells you. But if she tells you to do something that is disobeying Allah of Allah, do you listen to her? In that particular situation, no, you don't. So Al-Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, Allah raised him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah raised his station. Allah raised his... And the leader that came after brought Ahmad out of prison. He brought him out of prison. And he placed Ahmad in his house. And he brought him back all of his lessons. And all of his tadris and his ta'aleem and everything. Because what was realized was, he was a man of the deen, not a man of the dunya. He had no other alternative motive. He really was, this was Allah's deen he was trying to serve. And the leaders, they saw that they were wrong and Ahmad was right. So those are the students of Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala. Now we're going to go into the Hanbali madhab. What does it stand on? Okay, the first one is, the madhab stands on questions that were put to Imam Ahmad. And if you go to books that are called Masail Khalal, for example, and books like that, you will see that Ahmad ibn Hanbal's questions that were put to him and the answers that he gave. In there are his fatwas. In there are principles that he gives, and etc. That's the first important thing that the Hanbali madhab stands on. The second one is التخريج على أقواله. Huh? Huh? You're hungry? Okay. Number two, التخريج على أقواله. التخريج على أقواله means what? Ahmad gave what? Ahmad gave verdicts. He gave fatwas. Those fatwas are going to be taken and they're going to be applied on what? They're going to be applied on other situations. التخريج على أقواله. That's the second thing that the Hanbali madhab stands on. The third thing that it stands on is ijtihadat ulama al-madhab. The scholars of the madhab, they do ijtihad, the independent reasoning. And we'll speak about that in more details, inshallah, soon. But before we mention that, we have to break the Hanbali madhab into three levels. You have to learn this, brothers. The Hanbali madhab is how many tabaqa? Write this down. The Hanbali madhab is what? Three levels. How many levels? Three levels. Three tabaqat. The first one is al-mutaqaddimun, wal-mutawassitun, wal-mutaakhirun. So the first one is al-mutaqaddimun. Then it's what? Al-mutawassitun. And then the third one is al-mutaakhirun. The mutaqaddimun are the earliest, the mutawassitun are the middle, and the mutaakhirun are the late. The Hanbali madhab, you have to know these three tabaqat, these three levels, these three stages. The first one is from Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal's time. From whose time? Ahmad. It's from the time of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. Okay. In there are prominent scholars that we need to mention their names. In this level is Al-Khalal. Write down Al-Khalal, who died in the year 310. So in here, you have to know names that are in here. Ahmed Rahimullah is in there, of course. That's the Imam of the Madhab. In there is Khalal. He's in the early stages, the Mutaqaddimun, Khalal. You have to know him. He died in the year 311. In the first is Al-Khiraqi, and I'm going to mention that, who died in the year 334. Al-Khiraqi, who died in 334. He has a kitab called Mukhtasar. It's a summarized book. Mukhtasar Al-Khiraqi is called. Mukhtasar Al-Khiraqi is the kitab Ibn Qudama explained in the kitab Al-Mughni. The kitab Al-Mughni is a sharah of Mukhtasar. مختصر الخراقي. Also in there is Al-Hasan ibn Muhammad, who died here 403. In here, المتقدمون. Is who? Al-Hasan ibn Muhammad. He has a kitab called تهذيب الأجوبة. He has a kitab called تهذيب الأجوبة. He died here 403. This is the متقدمون. If you hear these scholars' names, what are we talking about? We're talking about the mutaqaddimun. These are the early scholars. Then we have the mutawassitun, the middle. Are we all together? Remember, it's differed upon how to organize it and whatnot, and who's who, but I don't want to confuse you. If you look at Ibn Badran, he mentioned something. I love the qawl of Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd mentions in his kitab Al-Madkhal Al-Mufassal. Lakin the point is that they all mention who's the mutaqaddimun, they differ on who should they take out. Are we all together? The mutawassitun, they differ. In the mutaakhirun, they differ. So what I just want you to remember is the figureheads who are in there. That's it. I mean, when does it start and when does it end? They differ amongst themselves. The second stage is the figureheads that are in here is Al-Qadi Abu Ya'la. Al-Qadi Abu Ya'la. This is the scholar that I mentioned to you. He wrote the kitab Tabaqat al-Hanabila. Al-Qadi Abu. Al-Qadi Abu Ya'la. He's in that. Al-Qadi Abu Ya'la rahimahullahu ta'ala. Also, if there is Abu al-Khattab Al-Kaluzani rahimahullah. Abu al-Khattab Al-Kaluzani rahimahullah. Also, in that level is Al-Wafa ibn Aqil, rahimahullah ta'ala. Abu al-Wafa ibn Aqil. Okay, let's just push this a bit back, okay? Here is also Abu al-Wafa. Abu al-Wafa ibn Aqil. Also, who died here 513. Also, Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah. Ibn al-Jawzi, who died here 597. Ibn Qudama. Ibn Qudama. Also, Abu al-Barakat ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Taymiyyah's grandfather. Abu al-Barakat ibn Taymiyyah. So I mentioned here Ibn al-Jawzi. I mentioned Ibn Qudama. I mentioned Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah al-Jadd. Ibn Taymiyyah al-Jadd means Ibn Taymiyyah the grandfather. The grandfather one is called what? Ibn Taymiyyah al-Hafid, right? Hafid means the grandson. Abu al-Barakat ibn Taymiyyah. Are we all together? Those are, and last but not least in there is Ibn Hamdan and Burhan ibn Muflih. Ibn Hamdan, Burhanuddin. Ibn Muflih. This is the middle stage now. All these figureheads, you just remember their names, and these people are in the mutawassitun. Then you have the last one, which is al-mutaakhirun. Again, brothers, just to put this out for you all, this is not verbatim. There are differences. Some may put this one into here, and some may take it from here, and some may put it here, and some may... It's differed upon who's from the mutawassitun and mutaakhirun and that. But it's just a sketch. It's an idea. Here, the mutaakhirun. And I really want you guys to focus highly on the mutaakhirun, because the Hanabila of today, they generally do not leave this stage. The Hanabila of today that you're seeing rarely take a step above this and talk about this or study this. They're really in this scope. This is where they are. This is where they do their i'tikaf. This is where they spend their life studying fiqh. وَلِذَلِكَ the fiqh of the Hanabila today, 80% or 90% of it is from here. And it's three people. Let's make it even more, four to be precise. It's four people. The first one is Al-Mardawi, Sahib al-Insaf. The second one is Ibn Najjar. Third one is Al-Hajjawi. And the fourth one is Al-Buhuti. Masur al-Idris Al-Buhuti. The first one is Al-Mardawi, rahimahullah. Al-Mardawi. Who died in 885. Who authored the Kitab al-Insaf. The second is Ibn al-Najjar. Are we all together, brothers? Then it's al-Hajjawi. Ibn al-Najjar died 972. And then al-Hajjawi is 968. And the last but not least is Mansur al-Buhuti. Mansur al-Buhuti, they call him Akhir al-Muhaqqiqin. They call him the last muhaqqiq of this madhab. So you don't see the Hanabila today go through the books of other than these imams. Whatever they done to haq, rather listen, pay attention to this. Mardawi, al-Mardawiyu, is the imam of tahqiq. Anything he authenticated, the madhab becomes it. ولذلك الشيخ محمد صالح العثيمين, do you guys know who he is? Sheikh Muhammad صالح العثيمين, huh? The book that Ibn Uthaymeen used to read, he read it so many times that the pages peeled out, the numbers and everything went, is the Kitab al-Insaf by Mardawi. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen gave his heart and his mind to this book. The Kitab al-Insaf, written by Mardawi. Sheikh Abdulsalam Shwair said this to me, that he stuck with this book, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, inside out. Rahimahullahu, rahmatan wasi'ah. So for them, Mardawi is the, it's him. Who is it? It's him. Mardawi is the one. And if you look at Ibn Najjar and Hajawiyu, both of them, they serve the works of Mardawi. They're the students, so they serve the works. And Buhuti, he's called Akhir al-Muhaqqiqin. Now they call him Sharih al-Madhab. Mansur ibn Idris al-Buhuti, Buhuti is the explainer. He explains those books. What did he do? Mansur ibn Idris al-Buhuti, he did shuruhat and explanation on it. Are we all together, brothers? Now I want to mention something which is, pay attention to this, brothers, is a series. Because remember we said we're going to, after we mention the madhab like this, we're going to go into the books, right? The books that are very important within the madhab, that are very, like, great, and it's big, is the following books written by Ibn Qudama. Write these books, they're very important that you know them. The books are Al-Umda. The Kitab Al-Umda is the first book written by. So we're talking about how many books? In this order. In what order, brothers? In this order. Brothers, pay attention to this. What's it called, the first one? Kitab Al-Umda, written by Ibn Qudama. Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi, Hanbali book. Okay, don't confuse it with Umdatul Ahkam. No, it's not. This is a Hanbali text. That's Al-Umda. Then comes Al-Muqni'. Al-Muqni'. Are you with me, brothers? Then comes the Kitab Al-Kafi by Ibn Qudama. And then comes the Kitab Al-Mughni. Those four books are in the order that we mentioned. The Talib, the student, he reads Al-Umda. Finishes it, studies it, masters it. Are we all together, brothers? And then he goes for the Kitab al-Muqni', goes through it, studies it, masters it. Goes for the Kitab al-Kafi, studies it and masters it. And then he reads the Kitab al-Mughni. ولذلك, the Kitab al-Mughni, Imam al-Dahabi mentioned in the Sir Alami Nubala, that Shaykh Izz ibn Abd Salam, Sultan al-Ulama, you know what he said? He said, Izz ibn Abd Salam is from one of the a'immatul mujtahideen, one of the great imams. Look what he said. Ma ra'aytu fi kutub al-islam fi al-ilmi. I never saw in the religion of Islam a book like Al-Muhalla ibn Hazm. The Kitab Al-Muhalla by Ibn Hazm, I have never seen a book like this. Wa Kitab Al-Mughni, and the Kitab Al-Mughni li-Shaykh Muwaffaq al-Din. And the last book, Al-Mughni. Walidarika, if a person does these four books, what are these four books in? In Fiqh al-Hanbali, right? And then he does one book which is called Rawdatu al-Nadir. What is it called? Rawdatu al-Nadir, by the author himself, which is in Usul al-Fiqh. Rawdatu al-Nadir is a summary, taking out all of the ilm al-mantiq and ilm al-kalam, which Abu Hamid al-Ghazali placed in the Kitab al-Mustasfa. Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, what did he do in his Kitab al-Mustasfa, which is Usul al-Fiqh book? He brought ilm al-mantiq and ilm al-kalam, which is not part of Usul al-Fiqh. Ibn Qudama, what did he do? He got rid of that he purified it and he brought it into this book called what? Rawdatul Nadir wa Jannatul Nadir. This Rawdatul Nadir, which is in Usul al-Fiqh, and these four books, if you study, you are an alim, mujtahid mutlaq. You can do ijtihad unrestrictedly. Walidhalika, Yahya al-Sarsari, Ibn Rajab mentions this in his kitab, Laylu Tabaqatil Hanabila. He praised these four books with the Rawdatul Nadir wa Jannatul Munadir. He praised it and he said, كَفَى الْخَلْقِ بِالْكَافِي وَأَقْنَعَ طَالِبًا بِمُقْنِعِ فِقْهٍ عَنْ كِتَابٍ مُطَوَّلِ وَعُمْدَتُهُ مَنْ يَعْتَمِدْهَا يُحَصِّلِ وَرَوْضَتُهُ ذَاتُ الْأُصُولِ كَرَوْضَةٍ أَمَاسَتْ بِهَا الْأَنْزْهَارُ أَنْفَاسَ شَمْأَلِ تَدُلُّ عَلَى الْمَنْطُوقِ أَوْفَى دَلَالَةٍ وَتَحْمِلُ فِي الْمَفْهُومِ أَحْسَنَ مَحْمَلِ. Those four books. كَفَى الْخَلْقِ بِالْكَافِي الْكَافِي كَفَى الْخَلْقِ بِالْكَافِي وَأَقْنَعَ طَالِبًا وأقنع طالبا بمقنع فقه عن كتاب مطول وعمدته من يعتمدها يحصل وروضته ذات الأصول كروضة أماست بها الأزهار أنفاس شمالي. These are the four books. All of them are which in فقه الحنبلي. And this book is in what? أصول الفقه. So you have أدلة الإجمالية and you have أدلة التفصيلية. You've taken them together, you have studied and you've gained a good understanding in this situation. Are we all together, brothers? Yeah. Now, inshallah ta'ala, I want to mention what is it today that the mutaakhirin, I mentioned what is the scholars today, the Hanabila today that you see in Saudi Arabia and other countries. When you go to the courtrooms in Saudi Arabia and others like that, because that's a Hanbali madhab book, it's a Hanbali madhab, right? In that, what do they judge by? I mean, what is it? What is being used here? They stick by two books. What do they stick by? They stick by two books. Talha Amos. They stick by two books. The first one is Al-Iqna' by Hajjawi. Al-Hajjawi already mentioned for you, here he is. Are you with me, brothers? What do they stick with? Al-Iqna' by who? Al-Hajjawi, that's the book that they stick with. And they give everything. And the last one they give time and effort to is Muntaha Al-Iradat by Ibn Najjar Al-Futuhi. Ibn Najjar? Yeah? Ibn Najjar, what did he? Muntaha al-Iradat. Al-Iqna' by Hajjawi and Muntaha al-Iradat. Yes. Those are the two books today, Madaru al-Fatwati wal-Qada. The fatwa in the Kaaba, the Haram when you walk in, and the scholars are giving fatwa, their fatwa revolves around the Iqna' and it revolves around Muntaha al-Iradat. Does that make sense, brothers? Does that make sense? Huh? The first one is Al-Iqna' by Al-Hajjawi, and the second kitab is Muntaha Al-Iradat by Ibn Najjar Al-Futuhi. It's called Muntaha Al-Iradat. The kitab is Al-Iqna' that's by Al-Hajjawi wrote it. Muntaha Al-Iradat. So if you go to the Kaaba today, a lot of the times if you listen and you've studied these books or you've gone over it, you realize that the fatwa of the scholars of the Haram, when you go to the courtrooms, you realize this is the fatwa that they give. They give it based on these two books. Unless, of course, you go to the Sheikh Wasiullah Abbas's side of the Haram, then he's going to give you the fatwa of Ahl Hadith. Yeah? Shaykh Rasulullah will not give you the Hanbali fatwa. Sah? Shaykh Rasulullah doesn't like tamadhub, following madhab, sah? He's against following madhab. I remember one time, Shaykh Rasulullah and Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ruhayli were sitting together. Yeah? Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ruhayli is a Hanbali. He goes to the Hanbali madhab and he teaches Hanbali texts. Are we all together? And Shaykh Wasi'ullah was asked a question about issue of madhab and whatnot. He said, I believe madhab is garbage. Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ruhayli is sitting there. They're sitting together. The video is on YouTube. I was like, sure. Oh, Allah. Yeah, Shaykh Wasi'ullah. Yeah? He said, madhab is garbage. Garbage, he said. He said, follow the Quran and the Sunnah. Shaykh Sulaiman al-Ruhayli didn't say anything. He just went quiet. Listen to it. He didn't say anything. Shaykh Wasi'ullah is very staunch when it comes to madhab. Even one time in the haram, one brother told me, he finished, I think, Sahih al-Bukhari or Sahih Muslim, one of the Kutub al-Sitta. And when he finished, he said, this is ijazah for anyone who doesn't follow madhab. I finished the kitab Sahih al-Bukhari, and it's an ijazah. Sahih al-Bukhari is an ijazah for anyone who doesn't follow madhab. Sahih al-Bukhari is not a madhab book. Shaykh Rasulullah. From India. لكنه والله إذا إمام والله إذا العالم حقا راح حفظه الله تعالى ورعاه. Okay, we finished أهم المؤلفات في المذهب الحنبلي. We're now going to go into the last point, which is المصطلحات الخاصة بالروايات والأقوال, terminologies. I'm only going to mention one, which is المصطلحات الخاصة بالروايات والأقوال. When they talk about روايات, the حنابلة, when they're transmitting narrations, when they're transmitting the views of the Imam, their terminologies that they use, that's the most important thing that you need to know about them. ولذلك the Hanbali madhab, if you look at the other madhahibs, they don't have this issue of glorifications of people like that. Other madhahibs, you find al-Imam, Qadi al-Qubat. That's why when it comes to the mustalahat, the terminologies that they use for people is very little. They use more for what? The works and the efforts and the knowledge itself, which is a praiseworthy thing about the madhab of the Hanabila, and the madhab of Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah ta'ala. Whereas the Shafi'iyya and the Malikiyya and the Ahnaf, they say Imam, they refer to one particular person. And they don't mean anyone else. هكذا. Are you with me, brothers? And they say قاضي القضات. Are you with me, brothers? وهكذا. Statements like that. The Hanabila are not very... ولذلك the Hanabila were not even... As a madhab, they were not about taking positions once they gained knowledge. The Hanbali madhab was never about taking positions once they gained knowledge. They were all about, once they gained knowledge, they used to go towards at-ta'abbud wal-ibadah wa ifadati an-nas. Like in the other madahibs, you tend to find, like the Shafi'iyya and the Hanafiyya, the most of those two, once they gained knowledge and they understood the religion, they went for positions. Oh, they became qadis. Naam. So let's focus on istilahatul Hanabila. The Hanabila, when they use the word ar-riwayah, the Hanabila, when they use the word al-riwayah, they mean the statement that's attributed to Imam Ahmad. If they say al-riwayah, they mean what? Al-qawlul mansub, the statement that's attributed to Imam Ahmad Muhammad. What about when the Hanbali books you see in the word al-tanbihat? Al-tanbihat. Tanbihat. What do they mean by that? What does actually tanbih even actually mean? What does tabih in English mean? Yeah, attention, bringing something to your attention or things like. When the Hanabila use the word at-tanbihat, they mean nabaha. It was brought to our attention by Imam Ahmad. Tanbih here, tanbihat means things Ahmad ibn Hanbal brought to their attention. But how is the difference between that one and the riwayah? The difference between a riwayah is bi'ibarati sariha. Riwayah is direct statement of the Imam. Like in this one, it's ibara, the terms and the way that is being transmitted from the Imam is not direct. Okay? It was understood from his speech. What about when they say, Al-awjuh. Awjuh means different faces, different forms. When they say the word al-awjuh, 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 what do they mean by that? Al-awjuh, they mean ashabul madhab, the students and the people of the madhab, their view, their statements. Aqwalu عند الأصحاب. The statements that are with, that are with who? The scholars of the. What about when they use the word المتقدمون والمتأخرون والمتوسطون? We already spoke about that, right? They will mention that a lot. They will say هذا عند المتأخرون, and this is عند المتقدمون, and this is عند. That's what they say. This is what they say. Also, it is important that you learn the difference between the word حتى, in, and low, according to Hanbali madhab. The word hatta, sometimes they say something, hatta, even if. Hatta here means that there is a strong difference of opinion in this issue. Whereas, in, it shows that the khilaf is moderate. Low, it means that the khilaf is very weak. And it's that level. The first, hatta when it's used, it means khilaf is very strong. In, the khilaf is, okay, it's moderate. There's a way out. The agreement and the khilaf are equilibrium, huh? And then there's low. Low is what? Weak khilaf. It's a what? It's a weak khilaf. Inshallah ta'ala, we finished the four imams, the four great imams, and their madhabs, and their school, and their books, in a very summarized manner. We finished, alhamdulillah. And this should give you an understanding of any of the four madhabs that you want to study from now onwards. How they work, how they are, and what their books are, and etc. These notes that I gave you may not be something you understand the first time. You may have to go over it 10 times. And if it does require 10 times, then do it 10 times. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.